Oh, hey there. Pretty cool track, eh? Kind of wish you had learned something like that in school. Actually, hip-hop could bring quite a few interesting things to music education. Much more than simply diversifying curricula, taking inspiration from the structure and culture of hip-hop could provide the basis for incorporating elements of both well-established and more cutting-edge pedagogical theories. Namely, the critical pedagogy of Paulo Freire and knowledge building as developed by Scamandalia and Barreto. Broadly speaking, the culture of hip-hop, stemming from the conditions of its emergence, not just as a musical genre, but a whole subculture, worldview, and mode of expression, carries with it central elements of critical pedagogy. Similarly, the participatory compositional style of hip-hop beats has many common characteristics with knowledge building and the kind of community dynamics it's based on. So before getting into the details, I'll go over a little bit of what hip-hop really is. Now, I'm just going to sort of scratch the surface, but if you're interested in the full story, I suggest resources like Black Noise by Trisha Rose, Can't Stop Won't Stop by Jeff Chang, That's the Joint, the Hip-Hop Studies Reader by Foreman and Neal, or even the Netflix documentary series Hip-Hop Evolution, hosted by the well-known rapper Shad. Of course, all my sources will be referenced down in the description, along with a script showing all the citations. So more than just music in the form of DJing and rapping, hip-hop is really an umbrella term that includes visual art like graffiti and breakdancing as well. And while this analysis could be applied to all these elements, I'll just be focusing on the musical ones. So hip-hop emerged from poor and racialized communities in Bronx, New York in the late 70s and early 80s with what were essentially dance parties put on by DJs. These DJs would set up their equipment in public or community spaces and not just play, but begin to manipulate the records, finding ways to repeat small sections and/or combine music of different styles. As the practice progressed, other prominent partygoers would start speaking and hyping up the crowd while the DJs produced the music. This is where the formula of speaking over spliced together bits of instrumentals got its start, and progressed from there into the hip-hop that we know today. It is these conditions which give rise to the two primary threads I'll be looking at. The social conditions, which would soon become the main theme of hip-hop lyrics, provide the foundation for convergence with the elements of critical pedagogy, and the technical expressive practices of DJing, mixing and manipulating pre-existing music, which give way to elements common with knowledge building. So let's start with the common ground hip-hop has with critical pedagogy. Critical pedagogy, of course, stemming from the work of Brazilian educator Paulo Freire and his foundational work, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, which presented a radical view of education as something that could equip marginalized people with the tools to transform their circumstances and thus society, as opposed to just fitting into where society wanted to place them. Freire's approach to education remains relevant to this day, so explaining it and all the discourse around it could be its own video. So for now, I just want to focus on two main areas of overlap. His concept of conscientization, or in Portuguese,
conscientização.
Yeah, that. Also known as naming the world, and a dialogical education involving coming to voice or taking action to bring about transformation. So starting with conscientization or naming the world, the connections here are quite explicit. We can understand these ideas as a form of critical consciousness, viewing the social relations and one's place within them through a critical lens as opposed to taking these social structures for granted, and being able to see and speak to the social forces that might be marginalizing you and your community. Speaking about and drawing attention to these structures is of particular importance and is something hip-hop has been known for since the very beginning. While it's arguably less the case presently, in its early days, hip-hop music was largely focused on naming the oppression African-Americans faced, and this was very much what the hip-hop movement and hip-hop culture was based on. Particularly once it became popular, hip-hop music was a way for some of the most marginalized members of American society to name and make widely known the oppressive conditions they faced, including poverty, police brutality, and so on, by talking directly about their lived experiences in their communities, which were not usually talked about in any other medium, at least not from their perspective. Hip-hop thus provided a vehicle for spreading not only specific critiques of prevailing power structures, but a template for naming these conditions and developing a critical consciousness towards them. This foundational element of hip-hop coincides with this foundational element of critical pedagogy. Freire's use of the term conscientization to refer to the realization of one's position in society and the social forces that kept and placed them there. For him, this knowledge is the basis for the potential praxis he saw in education, and which we can now observe in hip-hop as it is also based on the same foundation of naming and understanding the social forces, both present and historical, that produced the oppression of African-Americans in the late 20th century. Well, one could argue that these themes are not as popular as they once were, as hip-hop has come to dominate the mainstream music industry. There's still actually no shortage of modern examples of hip-hop songs which name the world. Take one of my personal favorites, for example, this song from the rapper Common.
Here we go again. Trayvon will never get to be an older man. Black children, they childhood stole from them, robbed of our names and our language. Stole again. Who stole the soul from black folk? Same man that stole the lamp for cheap black smoke and made the whip crackle on our back slow. Made us go through the back door and raffle black bodies on the slave blocks. Now we slaves to the blocks, on them we spray shots. Leaving our own to lay in a box. Black mother's stomach stay in a knot. We kill each other, it's part of the plot. I wish the hating would stop. War! And a battle with us. I know that black lives matter and they matter to us.
Not bad, eh? Listen to how in just a short time he connects colonization to the slave trade to the current state of violence in marginalized communities. So what does this mean in the context of education? Well, this translates into a radically student-centered approach. And teaching hip-hop doesn't necessarily have to mean loot beats and rapping as much as it can mean giving students the opportunity to name their social conditions through music. This could potentially be in whatever style they like, however, it remains likely that at the current moment that music will probably be hip-hop anyway. What is more important to remember is how central this naming the world is to hip-hop as an art form. While it is technically possible to separate it out and have hip-hop that is sanitized of this quality, which again is not hard to find in the current mainstream, it remains a key element of the history of the music and cannot be left behind when bringing it into the classroom, as we would also aim to honor the history of any music we want to teach. While there may be relatively fewer and further between, there are a few pre-existing models for teaching hip-hop that draw on critical pedagogy. These approaches involve rejecting what's referred to as the banking method, or deficit model, in favor of giving students more agency to partake in inquiry and meaning-making through what's referred to as the problem-posing model. So instead of giving students a piece of music to simply learn and perform, they're given the task of drawing on their own experience and identifying a topic or issue salient to them to explore and express through music, just as an early hip-hop artist would. Doing so preserves this core element of hip-hop in being a tool for conscientization and speaking to one's own lived reality in ways that other composers or songwriters, who may be long dead, cannot. This approach also lays the foundation for a second element of critical pedagogy, which teaching hip-hop can help facilitate: dialogue through action and transformation. In the words of Freire himself, functionally, oppression is domesticating. To no longer be prey to its force, one must emerge from it and turn upon it. This can be done only by means of the praxis, reflection, and action upon the world in order to transform it. In this light, hip-hop itself could be viewed as a component of praxis. It is not just a reflection of the social conditions of marginalized people, but a thrusting of those realities into the public consciousness, and forcing people who could otherwise ignore these conditions to be aware of them. As highlighted before, students can also take part in this process, reflecting on their own experiences and come to voice, or take action by creating music based on meaningful themes in their own lives such that authority figures must take notice of those issues. While these pieces of music may not become mainstream hits, they can still constitute a step towards addressing these issues, in other words, a step towards transformation. At the very least, doing so will make the teachers more aware of what is important to students and move toward a more dialogical pedagogy where the actions and interventions performed by teachers are informed not just by standardized curricula, but by the needs of their specific students. A great example of students being given just such an opportunity was in a dialogue set up by Louis Rodriguez in the summer of 2007 in Miami, which he details in his article, Dialoguing, Cultural Capital, and Student Engagement, Toward a Hip-Hop Pedagogy in the High School and University Classroom. Here he describes how he got a group of high school students from marginalized backgrounds to research social issues that affected them, including issues with schooling like discrimination from teachers, and present their findings to a class of teacher candidates. While this presentation didn't necessarily take the form of a hip-hop performance, it easily could have, and was indeed informed by the hip-hop culture which the students also consider themselves a part of. As Rodriguez explains, it is clear to me that hip-hop culture both directly and indirectly informs and challenges the work of educators. The manner in which knowledge about hip-hop culture can serve as a source of community cultural wealth is a revolutionary idea and an even more revolutionary practice. Whether in the backdrop or in the forefront, hip-hop can act as a vehicle for students to partake in Freirean dialogical pedagogy that has them reflecting on their own experiences, taking action through music, and potentially transforming their realities to address the issues that they themselves identified. perhaps this is a good point to address what is often the elephant in the room when it comes to talking about including hip-hop in music education. Isn't it inappropriate? While some of it certainly is, yes. As I mentioned before, not all hip-hop has retained the critical perspective that founded it. So one does have to be a little bit selective to some degree when choosing what to examine or what to use as a model. Currently, the subgenre dubbed conscious hip-hop retains the most critical perspective. Going further, however, the same critical consciousness that informs hip-hop can be turned right around and used to critique it, and a number of scholars encourage doing just that and having students critically analyze the elements in hip-hop music that might be problematic. This will most likely lead either back to the way hip-hop is rooted in the experience of marginalized people and how it is a reflection of the social conditions that led to and sustain the marginalization, or how the ensuing popularity of the genre was co-opted by the mainstream music industry for commercial purposes and stripped of these critical elements, while maintaining the aesthetics and superficial themes. So with that, we can continue on to the other pedagogical theory that including hip-hop in music education can help facilitate: knowledge building. Knowledge building is a more modern theory pioneered by Oizy's own Marlene Scott-Amelia and Carl Barreto, which centers students as a learning community instead of treating them as isolated individuals so as to create a dynamic where a group of students can learn or build knowledge with minimal intervention by teachers, giving them greater agency in their inquiry. While this approach has many interesting components and philosophies, I'll be focusing on just a few of the 12 knowledge-building principles that coincide with structural elements of hip-hop and thus provide a way to bring these aspects of knowledge-building into the classroom. To use some of what I've talked about so far as an example, knowledge building includes principles such as real ideas, authentic problems, idea diversity, and epistemic agency, which could encompass the use of students' own lived experiences as starting points for musical compositions, providing real and diverse ideas, and centering them as agents in the resulting dialogue that addresses these issues. However, there are other aspects of hip-hop that align more specifically with other knowledge-building principles and its focus on students as a knowledge-building community, with certain dynamics and rules of engagements between its members. For those, we have to look at the instrumental side of hip-hop and the construction of the beats that provide the backdrop for the lyrics that encapsulate the themes that I've discussed so far. So going back to the history of hip-hop and the dance parties where it originated, the beats in many ways came before the rhymes. The musical style we know today, which is now even being played and performed instrumentally, originally came from mixing and manipulating existing music from genres such as funk, Motown, disco, and reggae. One of the most common practices was isolating instrumental sections known as breaks, especially drum breaks or drum solos, and playing them repeatedly. This is really where break dancing comes from, as they were dancing over the breaks. As technology progressed and devices like samplers became more common, hip-hop artists could further isolate clips or even individual sounds to use in the construction of their beats. However, it was still based on putting together bits and pieces of existing music as opposed to performing anything themselves. From this, we get the hip-hop beats, which have become much more elaborate in the intervening years and are now often comprised of original material, but still take the form of a short, repeated section of music. While both methods of creating hip-hop beats contain potential benefits, it's the practice of sampling that really contains the community dynamics similar to those of a knowledge-building community. Looking again at knowledge-building, we see the principle of improvable ideas, the notion that all ideas are at least worth trying to improve even if they don't ultimately lead anywhere. In other words, the investigation of possibilities is worth the effort. This workshop mentality can also be found in sampling, which can often involve trial and error, not only in finding and piecing together samples, but doing so in an iterative process where trends can emerge in a community. Ideas and contributions are innocent until proven guilty, in a sense, not assumed to be true or false, useful or useless, until they've been explored by the community. This leads to another principle, rise above, which is the notion that a particularly promising idea or combination of ideas can be synthesized or otherwise made the foundation of a leap forward in understanding. In the world of hip-hop beats, this can take the form of a particularly popular sample or production method emerging as a trend and becoming a vehicle for further creativity in finding new ways to use and contextualize that sample or method, leading to even further creative innovation with that common idea as a foundation. These innovations themselves then become the basis for further synthesis and rising above in an iterative process. Think of the Amen break, the most sampled break in hip-hop that's been used on countless tracks. To hear why rap is not a joke, for us it's a career. Others are with, it's what I give them, just to kill, it's how I'm living. When I'm called off, I got a sawed off, squeeze the trigger and bodies are hauled off. Horn is Chinese arithmetic.
on the tip of her tongue.
I'm like, what happened to us? Maybe I'm rapping too much. I've been missing your touch. Sometimes I'm out and I lust.
Keep the facts, stupid loser, find a rope to hang. I'm not bipolar, see, I'm just known by those couple names.
It's been sped up, slowed down, cut up and repeated, and used in all sorts of different ways. Once DJs and producers saw how it could be manipulated, that acted as inspiration for them to give it a try. Here we begin to see the community dynamic come into view, which is expressed in the principle of community knowledge, which maintains that ideas essentially belong to the community and contributions are aimed at the advancement of the whole community as opposed to being personal possessions. Again, in the context of sampling, everything is on the table. Remember, sampling started by taking a piece of what was copyrighted music and using it for one's own purposes. So within the context of sampling, there is little sense of ownership, at least over the materials or production methods of a beat. All aspects of creation are available themselves for being sampled. Such an open workshop-like dynamic also allows for symmetric knowledge advancement, which involves a community moving and advancing together with every member making contributions. Instead of having more or less knowledgeable members, everyone is privy to the current state of knowledge and takes part in its development. Again, without individual ownership over compositions or methods, all participants are able and invited to contribute to the discourse, and these contributions are not judged based off of who made them, but how they advance the collective knowledge. Or in the case of hip-hop, the quality of the beats. Ultimately, the goal is a knowledge-building discourse, which starts with the explicit aim of knowledge advancements. So in a knowledge-building discourse, the sharing of knowledge, sampling, and the refinement and transformation of that knowledge, modifying, sampling the modifications, goes beyond the simple sharing of knowledge from those who possess it to those who don't, i.e. from teacher to student, to the act of working with and working on that knowledge in an ongoing participatory process that involves all community members. So these principles may sound vague and more like philosophy than concrete pedagogy, but that is where hip-hop and the sampling culture that comes with it can provide a scaffold for incorporating these principles into music education. So as opposed to working entirely individually, learning pieces and performing them for a teacher, students can be tasked with sourcing material of their choosing that is meaningful to them and constructing something out of these samples. Then, sharing it collectively and responding to the creations of others, potentially through further creations that draw inspiration from the creations of their peers. The philosophy of hip-hop sampling has also been employed beyond musical context to things like research skills and self-reflection. In fact, connecting back to the previous discussion of hip-hop's relation to critical pedagogy, in responding to some of his critics, Ferretti stated that his prescriptions were meant to be adapted to one's context, or in other words, sampled. It's also worth noting that sampling culture is also a product of the social conditions discussed earlier that gave rise to hip-hop, namely that hip-hop artists didn't have access to formal musical training and had to use what they had at their disposal. So, having come full circle, we can see how hip-hop can be a powerful tool for bringing both more established and more cutting-edge pedagogical theories into the music classroom in the form of the praxis and dialogue of critical pedagogy through drawing on students' lived experiences and the development of a knowledge-building community through a participatory sample culture. This, of course, is not necessarily a simple or straightforward task. There are always going to be caveats and exceptions, and I, of course, cherry-picked aspects of hip-hop based on their applicability to the pedagogy. That being said, I hope I've also given you a few things to think about, maybe some inspiration to listen to some new music or listen to some familiar music in a new way. As long as I've got those wheels turning, those creative juices flowing, and you're considering some new ways to approach music education, then I've done my job. So, thanks for watching, and catch you on the flip side. Okay, where was I?